The Christians facing persecution were always going to reject those texts in which their Savior didn't lead by example. So docetic works like the Gospel of Peter, in which Jesus himself never really suffered on the cross, were singularly unhelpful. And in a battle for the survival of the fittest, they were bound to fall by the wayside. But perhaps the factor that most influenced the selection of any text was its authorship. For a book to be included, it had to be the authentic work of an apostle. So how did the early church leaders decide which texts were the genuine work of apostles and which weren't?
With some difficulty, just the short answer. Obviously, those texts that claimed to be by an apostle, those that had an apostle's name in it, so, you know, the Apostle Paul to the Romans or to the Corinthians, that helped. It at least made it worth discussing. In other cases, texts seem to have acquired apostolic authorship, as far as we can tell, simply by tradition. In the case of the Gospel of Matthew, which is attributed to the Apostle Matthew, or in the case of the Gospel of John, attributed to the Apostle John, neither of these texts says it was written by these people, and yet from the very earliest references to them by name, they are ascribed to such figures. So if you ask, well, how did that happen? And the answer is, I don't know, nobody else knows for sure. It happened so early, but it appears to have been obviously something other than the text claiming it to be so and its claim being accepted. It appears to have been just a kind of tradition that was associated with these texts.
What about the Gospel of Thomas? The Gospel of Peter.
Yeah, Gospel of Peter, Gospel of Thomas, Gospel of Mary, Gospel of Philip, all of these explicitly claim to be written by those figures. And these figures are, you know, apostolic generation figures. And yet all four of them were not included in the canon. One of the things they had going against them was it appears that they were written actually, in their present form at least, significantly later than the canonical Gospels. They got a late start and they didn't make it. Those that had been written earlier and had more of a chance to circulate and to make their claim and to get that claim accepted, if they were able to do so, stood a better chance.
And so, very gradually, a consensus of opinion began to form. By the mid-second century, hundreds of churches across the Roman Empire had started to decide, informally at first, which texts were and which weren't to be included. For a number of books, the debates were relatively muted, but others generated considerable disagreement. The Shepherd of Hamas, a book of visions, was hugely popular in the early centuries of the church, appearing in lists of accepted Christian literature until as late as the 5th century. And then suddenly it dropped out, judged to be too recent and written not by an apostle, but only the brother of a bishop. Therefore, not Holy Scripture. In the same way, the inclusion of Revelation, the last book of the New Testament, which describes the end of the world in vivid detail, wasn't a foregone conclusion. It seems impossible to imagine a canon without the horseman of the apocalypse or 666, the number of the beast. But believe it or not, the book of Revelation nearly didn't make it. In the 4th century, bishops argued it should be omitted because of the difficulties involved in interpreting its complex symbolism. But it was saved at the last minute when early Christian leaders became convinced that it was written by Jesus' disciple John, even though the author himself never makes such a claim. So apostolic authorship, real or attributed, could be decisive. But so could a gospel's content. Bart Ehrman believes that unless a book helped ensure the fledgling faith's chances of survival, it didn't stand a chance. Would Christianity have been as successful a religion if the books that had been left out had been left in?
If Christianity had taken the books of the Ebionites, it would have been a Jewish canon that would have appealed to Jewish Christians, but wouldn't have had widespread appeal to the Gentiles, who made up the majority of the empire at the time. If Christianity had taken over the canon of Marcion, it would have excluded the Old Testament and wouldn't have had any claim to antiquity. In a world in which antiquity was very important, people in the ancient world thought that for a religion to be true, it had to be ancient, and the Marcionite religion wasn't ancient. It was a new thing. The Gnostics had texts that were elitist in nature, where only the insiders could understand the truth that could bring about salvation. Christianity would have become a closed elitist society that wouldn't have had widespread appeal. My sense of things is that if Christianity hadn't formed an orthodoxy, a single coherent understanding of the faith with a canon of scripture, that probably Christianity would not have taken over the Roman Empire.
So why was this emphasis on unity so important?
When the Roman Emperor Constantine converted to the faith in the year 312, he wanted to use this religion as a way of unifying his fragmented empire. If Christianity were highly fragmented at the time of Constantine, then he wouldn't have seen the political value of committing himself to Christianity. And if Constantine hadn't converted to the faith, then the Roman Empire never would have converted to the faith, and we never would have had Western Christianity.